Good evening, everybody. Hopefully we're all caffeinated and energized this evening. I was needing some today about 3 o'clock. I was hurting kind of bad today mentally, but it is great to be here with y'all, to get away from work and the world and school and whatever else might be going on in our lives. It's great to be with y'all this evening and see some smiling faces. We are picking back up in our study of what is the church. We started this on Sunday. A two-part lesson, of course, and so we'll be wrapping that up. Same outline as last Sunday, so if you have one from last Sunday, it's the same one. Just flip it over. We've got the Wednesday PM study on the back, the outline on the back there. We got through most of what we were trying to get through on Sunday. We have a few other things to cover on that. But where we started on Sunday, where it was trying to define what is the church, as we look through the Bible, there's a couple different perspectives we can get on what the church is. We see it talked about in a couple different ways. And as a newcomer to Christ, as someone who's been recently baptized, or from someone that's come from a different congregation locally or in the U.S., there might be some different thoughts or opinions on what the church is, or an understanding on what the church is. And as we've talked about, and I think the last 3 or 4 of our Sunday sermons, we're growing pretty quickly here at Taylor's congregation. And I thought it a pertinent time to take us through this to study on what the church is in all the respects that we can get from the Bible. We went through a couple questions, and I told you before that our main goal I wanted to get to was to wind up with kind of an elevator pitch of what the church is, so we can reference that. And we can use that then to understand what the church is not, if we have that understanding. And so we'll use that as kind of a recap tonight, because that's the one part we didn't get to on Sunday. But we had the 5 questions that we went through. We'll go through this pretty quickly. But the answer to this, again, we'll take and we'll put on a slide here in just a minute, and we'll see all that together. But as a recap, who did we say that the church belongs to? Jesus Christ, correct. As the title is up there, Christ's church. That's a pretty easy answer. It's his church. He possesses it. He has built it. And because it's his, who has authority over it? He does. Jesus does. Our second question, how many churches are there? How many churches of Christ? How many churches does Christ have? Did he establish? One. There was only one. There's a lot of ones that we talked about in regard to that. Ephesians 4:4, there was the one body, the one spirit, the one baptism. All those all tied together to give us Christ's one church. There's only one. Another question was, who makes up the church? Christ's body, the members. I heard baptized believers. We'll get to that in the next one. These were the 2 points that we separated, but it's made up of Christ's body, which is the members. And then our next question, as we already answered, when does one become a part of this church? And that's when they are baptized into his death, burial, and resurrection. And then our final question was, when was this church started? Day of Pentecost. Ben did a great job in a sermon on Sunday talking a little bit more about that, how there was the group of Christ's followers in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost that received the apostles received the gift of the Holy Spirit, went out, and Peter preached on the day of Pentecost. And that day, after his preaching, and they admonished what he was, or they accepted what he was saying, they repented, and they were baptized. And it reads there that 3,000 were added to the number that day. Well, of course, they were added to the number that was already there in Jerusalem. And there we see that finally the church of Christ had members added to it. Now when we look back in Matthew, when Christ asked the apostles, whom do you believe this church, or whom do people say that I am? And Peter responds, after the other apostles give him wrong answers, that we believe you're the Christ. And that's when Jesus says, yes, correct. And this confirmation and this this proclamation that you make, Peter, is what I will build my church on. So Christ says he will build it at that point. And so from that point to this point, this is where we see the members that are added. So now the church has come to fruition, if you will. It's been created. Right, so if we put all those pieces together, all those little pieces of answers that we've gotten from those questions, we get our elevator pitch. We get our sales pitch, if you will, of what the church is. Christ's church is the one true church established on the day of Pentecost that belongs to Jesus Christ, over which he has complete authority, and whose members are his body, which are those who are added and saved when they repent of their sins and are baptized into his death and resurrection. Now, my English teacher probably wouldn't like this sentence too much because I think it's like six different run-on sentences. But that's okay. It serves a purpose. It achieves what we're going after tonight, is to condense the idea of what Christ's church is. When Christ and the apostles were teaching the Jews and the Gentiles and all those that were about, this is, in a nutshell, what they were teaching. This is the foundation for what they were teaching to the people. Our aim at the Taylor's Church of Christ is to do exactly what that first century church, what the apostles and what Christ instructed that first century church to do. That is our aim here, as our mission to be a true church of Christ, to belong to the church of Christ. Because of that, we have to follow Christ's authority, do we not? If he's the one that has possession over it, he's the one that's told us what to do. If we're trying to follow that example, it's his example that we need to follow. And that's why we are charged with studying the word and doing what we can to follow that. Christ's church is not a denomination. What's a denomination? What's the real meaning of denomination?
Division.
Division, something separate or something broken off of the original, correct? If we are to follow Christ's authority and the plan that he set out for his church, and we do follow that, then we truly are not a denomination. I said last week that I pass 8 different buildings or establishments with the word church on their sign. I think I counted 10 this time, so I must have missed some last week. But everyone's got a different name. Everyone has Assembly of God or the North Hills Church or the Community Church or Grace Church. None of them bear the name of Church of Christ. And as you look into what a lot of them study, the question is, do they study what Christ puts forth, what the apostles put forth, or do they break off of that? And if they break off of that, they then are a denomination. Correct. So if we adhere to what Christ has put forward for us, we are not a denomination. Well, they make it confusing because they think they're doing what is right.
They think they're part of the whole.
Right. Right. That's a very good point. Todd. I like that. And that's, I'm a keep it simple, simpleton kind of guy. I like to get to the root of what things are, and that's where this study on the church kind of came from. It's been something that's been in my head for a while, and that's it. If we want to make sure we're on the right path, we have to know exactly what we're studying. We have to go back and trace what Christ has told us that we need to do. Putting this all together, so now that we've established what the church is, what's the point of this all? What's the point of Christ's church? We haven't talked much about that just yet. We have a little bit here and there, but what is the point? Easy answer, softball question for somebody. What's the point of Christ's church?
Edify one another and be watchful for Jesus' return.
For the hope of
eternal
life, salvation. That's a lot better than how I had it written in my notes. Yes. For the hope that we will one day, or through our days, we will live according to how Jesus has commanded us to, and that when he comes again, we're going to be taken to that home in heaven that we've been promised. The point of it all is the gift of salvation. That is the point of it all. And that's beauty. That's beautiful. So now that we've established what Christ Church is, let's dig a little bit deeper. This is the start of two other points that people often get confused. So the universal church is a phrase that's thrown around quite a bit. Before we get into it, we're not going to find this in Scripture. We won't find this phrase in Scripture anywhere. This is a classification or just a phrase that man has come up with to help distinguish between the two types of perspectives of the church that we find in the Bible. So far, we've put together a pretty good definition of Christ's church. But again, as we look through the New Testament and the apostles' teachings, they refer to churches or different groups of people or the church in different regards. So when we say the universal church, let's try to understand what we're talking about there. If we go to Acts 2:38, Acts 2:38 and 39, we read this quite a bit last week. Peter, again, here on the day of Pentecost, is talking to a very large group. Starting in verse 38, Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Verse 39, "The promise is for you and your children and for all who are afar off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." So it tells us right there who he's teaching to, who will be saved, and who this gift of salvation of the Holy Spirit is, which we've determined is salvation, which we've determined those who are saved are Christ's body. So clearly he's identifying the audience here. So far, we've just talked about those who have been baptized, repented and baptized and saved. Here, Peter specifies promises for you, the people that are in front of us, your children, whether they're even born or they're not, for all those who are far off. So if someone's not here right now, if they're living in Alaska, I'd say that's pretty far off. What if they're a Christian? What if they've been baptized and saved for their sins? Then he goes on to say, for all whom the Lord our God will call. So when we look at what the universal church is, it's Christ's church, but it includes everyone that has been baptized and saved in the past, everyone who has currently been baptized into Christ, and everyone who will be baptized into his death and resurrection. All those who are saved, that is the universal church when we refer to it that way. Did I lose anybody? And making that point, because as we get into our next perspective of church, that will help lend some guidance, some distinction. Christ Church and the Universal Church, same thing. Do we see that? Do we see that? Before we move on to some more of the local church, sorry, I forgot to show the answer there. What are some misinterpretations of the word church that we commonly come across? Building. Got to get to the church building. Got to get to the church and mow the grass or clean the building or whatever we have to do, right? What's another misinterpretation that we often see, whether with ourselves or with other friends that attend different churches. Referring to services as the church. The services would be our worship or our Bible study, but if we call them that we're going to church, that's not actually correct. We are the church. People are the church. And then lastly, another one I have listed is a common institution. The church, have we seen anywhere in here where the church is an organization that needs to have an LLC and all the legal documentation behind it? Absolutely not. The church is not an institution. The church itself has no authority over Christ's church. Now we'll get more into that in the local church here in just a minute. Any questions, comments, anything to follow up with that? Tim?
We also have some who think the universe of the church is the aggregate of all the churches of Christ in the world. That's a bad way to look at it.
Right.
The universe of the church does not have a director except one maintained by God. God knows those that are his, those that are saved. They make up the universe of the church. Not just
correct. Thank you. Wayne.
The verse that I like to refer to is in the book of John, chapter 17, where Christ is praying in the garden before he's crucified, and he says, "Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may be one." That's the universal church there. "As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us.
That's a great submission. I didn't even think of adding that in there. That's a good verse. Thank you. No. I said thank you. I didn't think of adding that into my notes. I didn't come across that scripture in my mind to add that. It's a good summation. Right. All right, moving on. The local church. So as we read through the New Testament, we start to see another different mentioning of the church or perspective that's given. Again, we just talked about Christ Church and the universal church being the same thing, the church as a whole. But then as we get into it, we start to see some more specific churches that are mentioned. I tasked you guys on the outline to list some of the specific local churches that are mentioned in the New Testament. What are some of the churches that are mentioned that we see? Church at Ephesus, somebody over here? Jerusalem, we talked about. Thessalonica, Ephesus, Smyrna, the churches that are mentioned in the book of Revelation. Philippi, somebody said. Antioch, trying to get you guys to talk a little louder was my goal there, but we're getting there. It's good. We're getting there. Romans 16:16. All the churches of Christ is what's referenced there. And that's the first time this phrase we see, churches of Christ, is used. But it mentions all the churches of Christ. So how do we go from one universal church, Christ Church, to now churches, a plural version of the church? And that's what we're going to dig into a little bit more here. Again, we saw the different churches that we just mentioned. What we're going to do here, we're going to start actually with question 3 on the outline. We're going to go to question 3, 2, 4, and 1, just to help follow along logically. So sorry for mixing those up here, but I think it'll flow just a little bit better. Our first point I want us to talk about is, where did these local churches come from? We know where the Church of Christ came from, where his church that he established came from. We've talked about that. We've explained that. Now as we get into it, where do we find where these churches began? What is their point? Where did they come from? Turn with me to Acts 8, 1 through 4. Acts 8, 1 through 4. Now, Acts 8 isn't too much longer after the day of Pentecost. There's a lot of stuff that happens between Acts 2 and Acts 8 here. But in the grand scheme of things, it's not too far off in the timeline. Starting in verse 1, "And Saul approved of his execution, and there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem." So we talked about the church in Jerusalem being the original group of members. That's where the apostles were, the 120 of the followers of Christ. And that's where the 3,000 were added to. They were added to their numbers, so the Church of Jerusalem. That's what we're talking about here again. And they, the church in Jerusalem, were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church and entering house after house. He dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. So we see here, we know the story of Saul. We know the bad things that Saul did before his conversion. He's seeking out the Christians, these brand new Christians who have so excited. Every time I think of the fervor they must have for the word, the excitement they have for becoming a new Christian, this new life that they've been given, this promise of eternal life, a comfortable life, an amazing life in heaven after this life, they have to be filled with such joy. But yet, here's Saul at the time coming through, leading the charge to persecute them, to execute them, and they're scared. And they would do exactly what we would do if we were being persecuted to this degree. They flee, and they flee to all regions of the world. And as they flee, do you think they stop teaching the word that they were taught? Do you think they stop practicing that? If they were going to flee and stop practicing, then why even flee in the beginning? They can just stay where they are in their homes and not practice and not keep believing. They left, and they continued to preach. In James 1:1, we also see that as well. He addresses his epistle to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations. So we see that's where these churches came from, these different groups of people. We talked on Sunday morning what the Webster's definition of church is, or ecclesia, that is the Greek word in the Bible that's translated to church. That's a group of people with a religious task in mind together, in a religious assembly. That's exactly what they are. They've been persecuted. They've scattered. They're fearing for their lives, and they scatter to wherever they can to get safe. And they continue to teach what they've been taught as they've been commanded. Think on that just a little bit deeper. When Peter, on the day of Pentecost, is teaching, we have a really clear definition of who he's teaching to. Again, back in, I have the scripture listed there. One second, sorry. Back in Acts 8, picking back up in verse 6, back when Peter is preaching to them on the day of Pentecost. So Acts 2. I'm sorry, I've lost my place on that verse. I'll find it here in just a minute. Let me read what I have, and maybe that'll help jog my memory. I have in verse 6, and it's in Acts here. And when this sound occurred, so it was of the Holy Spirit, the multitude came together, and were confused because everyone heard them speaking. Sorry, this is in Acts 2, beginning of Acts 2. Acts 2, starting in verse 6. We made it. Acts 2, verse 6. And when the sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear each in your own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus in Asia, Phrygia, and all these places he's listing, Egypt and the parts of Libya, adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God." So here the Holy Spirit has enabled the apostles to speak in tongues, to speak in each of their own languages. But we, how many was that? 10 different areas that they've all come from, that they're from, different languages that they're speaking? About 14. Thank you. So if Peter's speaking to them, they're here to celebrate the day of Pentecost. They've gathered for this. This is a big event in the Jewish the Jewish faith, they've gathered to do this. Clearly, they've come from these parts of the world. After Peter's taught them, they got to go home at some point, right? After thousands of them have been converted and baptized, they're not just going to go back home and forget what they've been a part of, what they've been taught. They're going to continue teaching that. And that's where we see that these churches began, these different churches began from people going back to their homes or from being persecuted. And we know that as the great dispersion of the Christians, they were persecuted and they were spread out, but they continued to teach what they had been taught. And they joined together in local groups, churches. And that's what we see. Could have used that a second ago. The Great Dispersion. Question number two, I said we're going to go to now. Were these churches teaching something different than the universal church? At first, my answer was just read the New Testament epistles to the different congregations, to Galatians and Ephesians, kind of a softball answer I was giving there, but we get some we get a lot of input from the epistles, right? So we see what Paul and the apostles are, the letters that they're sending them. They do a couple different things in these messages. They commend them for their great works that they've done, or they even rebuke them for some of the things that we're doing. Galatians 1, Paul writes to the Galatians, and he actually tells them, I'm shocked at how quickly you've deserted the teaching of Christ. So when the gospel was preached by Paul and the others throughout the ancient world, different denominations were not set up. We talked about that. Again, this is the same teaching that was set forth by Christ and the apostles. And as they were spread out, as they began preaching on their own in their different areas, did the apostles just sit idly by and let them teach what they thought was right? What did the apostles do? Took many mission trips. They traveled, right? They were commanded to go in the Great Commission to go out and to teach all the world, to teach the word unto all the world. And they did that. And we have a great example of that. And so through, whether it be through epistles or through traveling and going to visit those congregations, those groups of people, to establish them or to check in on them, we have great examples all throughout the New Testament of where the apostles did that.
The Gospels were also written to document the eyewitness testimony of the life of Christ and his teachings so that the church would have those. And then the epistles were written to either encourage or correct or discipline. And that also becomes part of the teaching body that we use.
Correct. Thank you. David. Yes, thank you. And we'll get to that. I took some of the scripture I was going to use for this point, and we have it in our next, in our last point that we'll get to. So we'll get to some more of that, but that's exactly right. Thank you for that point. Other questions or comments? All right, question four. A little bit tougher point here. Is one automatically a part of a local church if they are a part of the universal church? Think on that just for a second. Think on the process that it takes for one to become a part of Christ's church. We've already established that. We've talked about that quite a bit. Turn to Acts 9, 26 through 27. And we'll look at this passage here. So if I repent of my sins, I'm baptized, I'm saved in Jesus through his baptism, I'm a part of his body, but then I move and I go off to college or I find myself in a local area. What's the point? What's there to do now? Am I automatically a part of the nearest congregation? What if the nearest church isn't a sound church, isn't following the authority of Jesus and following what they should be, right? Acts 9, 26 through 27. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, He tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him. I don't blame them. And did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles, and he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road, and he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. Saul's persecuting the Christians. He's on the road to Damascus. He's on a mission. It's knocked to the ground by a bright light. It blinds him. It's Jesus. Fast forward. He's converted. He's baptized. Barnabas is there to encourage him, to baptize him. He's converted. This is one of the next things that Paul does after he's converted. He looks for the same people he was after, because he knew what they were doing. He understood the power now of what they were doing. They were teaching the gospel, the message of Christ. They were building Christ's church. And again, what's the first thing he does? He goes to them. He goes to them because he wants to join them. He wants to join the work. He sees how important that is. Saul's example shows that the concept of a long-term visitor is not to be held by a faithful Christian active in God's work. And what I mean by that is, once we're baptized, we have a mission to do. We have a local congregation that we are to be a part of. I wish we had some more background on this story, or the book of Acts went a little bit deeper into this. I think that'd be such a cool story to hear on their initial time together. It just goes on to tell what actually happened, and Paul got right to work. He started preaching the word, and he was doing such a great job. He stirred up a crowd, and the apostles got him out of there because he was causing so much of a ruckus for everybody. He was probably going to have them all arrested and killed. But that initial work that he did with them is such a great example to us. We need to be a part of a work. But we have to seek that out. So based off this example, is one that is baptized into Christ Church automatically a part of the local church? What can we deduce from that? Sarah. And they didn't even receive him right when he wanted to join the work. Can you imagine? I commend our elders for the work that they do and getting to know new members in the area and visitors that we have. I know it's very high on their list to get to know those people, and they do a great job with that. I think we've all had the meeting with the elders at some point. And what a great thing that we have, because it's not that they want to screen out people, but they want to make sure that anybody that's coming has a great understanding of what's going on here at the Taylor's Church of Christ. If I said anything you guys want to add up on that, feel free.
Well, they might want to screen out some.
Right.
Just like the church in Jerusalem was going to screen out Paul because of his reputation.
Right.
And Barnabas kind of set that straight.
Right.
I was going to say, like, when you think about Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian, you know, on the road to Gaza, Philip comes and preaches to him, and he becomes a baptized believer. Well, was he added to the church? Well, the Lord, of course, adds to the church. Was he part of a local church? Not at that point, he was. Was there one to join in Ethiopia? I don't know. I don't know about that. I guess maybe he could have become that local church if there's no one else there. But then with Paul, becoming a baptized believer, coming to Jerusalem, you know, the importance of joining oneself we see the importance of being a part of a local church.
Right, right, exactly. That takes us to our next point, actually. This was, everything we've said so far is going to get tied up in this last point. So question number one, what were some of the things these churches did? Right. So here we have our responsibilities as members, right? Some great scripture here, some great examples, I think, tell us and paint a great picture of what it is, not only what our responsibilities are as members of a local church, but you can flip that and you can also get, what can we get out of the local church? I want to be careful when I say that because there's a lot of people that I know, a lot of younger people that I know have grown up with have fallen away because it's that right there. What do I get out of the local church? That's not the point of the local church. There's things to be had. There's rewards to be had, which we'll get into in just a minute. But if we're coming to church to worship God and to be a part of this, to get something out of it for us, then we have the wrong mindset. Everything we've studied so far does not tell us that's the goal, right? And I want to make that clear. And it's sad to see that. There's been many that I know. There's many today in denominations, and that's why I think a lot of the denominations are doing so well and drawing so many people because they're after what people want to get out of a church, out of an assembly, out of a group of people. Our job is to worship God and to keep his commandments and to obey his authority. Turn to Acts 2:42 verses, and then 44 through 47. In Acts 2:42, we can see we're very familiar with this. This is another Lord's Supper scripture that's read quite a bit. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and to the breaking of the bread and the prayers. So first easy answer, we're to commune with each other. On Sunday, that's the main focus of our time being together. We're commanded to get together, to partake of the Lord's Supper, to remember his death, to commune with each other and with the Lord through that. That's our main focus. We also use that time to worship with one another. A couple verses down in Acts 2, 44 through 47, it continues on, and all the believers were together and had all things in common, and they would sell their property and possessions and share them with all to the extent that anyone had need. Day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together in gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. Another example, they met together and broke bread together. Now, this broke bread together is a little bit different meaning than they communed together. What I gather from this scripture is they took care of each other. They were there for each other. They didn't just sell all their possessions. They didn't just meet with... They did everything that they needed to do to take care of one another. That's something that we can get out of our church, out of our fellow brothers and sisters. We have some that are going through losses at this time. We have some that are going through sicknesses. We've been through quite a bit of that in my short time here of 3 years. There's been a lot of that. But every time something bad has happened... Every time that happens, it's amazing to me how many people in this congregation step up and are there for anybody that needs the help and the support. That is a responsibility. That is a huge responsibility as us, as members of this local congregation. And I think we excel at that here. They worship together. 1 Corinthians 14:26. What then shall we say, brothers and sisters, when you come together, each of you has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Everything must be done so that the church may be built up. They submitted themselves to one another. Ephesians 5:19-21. One another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. If we go back to the point of, man, I'm just not getting anything out of church these days. How wrong that is, if we look at this point, if we are submitting ourselves to one another, we're not thinking of ourselves. If we're truly submitting ourselves to one another as brothers and sisters with love that we've been commanded to do, we're going to be there for each other. We're going to be supportive of each other just the way that we are at Taylor's Congregation. I know that's the goal of a lot of us here, and that's what we should be striving to do. This is the last point. James 5:19-20, we're to hold each other accountable. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save from death and cover a multitude of sins. We're here to keep each other on track, to keep each other on track in God's word, to encourage each other, to be there to support each other when we need it. And we all know we need it in the world that we live in today. That's what this local church is here for. Thank you. Thank you for your participation going through that with us. If you have any questions on that, find one of our elders. They'd be glad to answer that for you. Come talk with me. Thank you for the comments on Sunday and throughout the week that I've gotten. I appreciate that. Whoever's teaching next, their outline is in the foyer there. Todd is teaching Sunday and Wednesday. Thank you.